Okay, the substantive motion is carried. Can we move on to the Mayoral Recommendations, Council Tax Support Scheme, I believe Council Lambert has going to do that.
Lord Mayor, I move that the recommendation in relation to Council Tax Support Scheme are set out on pages 25 to 156 of the Council's agenda be approved.
There are no amendments, are there any questions? I can't see any hands going up, so is that agreed?
Agreed.
We move on to the next item, the establishment of local authority housing company, Mayor Anderson, OBE, to move.
Just like one of the previous ones, just to find on the Council Tax Support Scheme. It's a pity that the Greens went through with an amendment congratulating this administration for support, accepting and keeping it going in the difficult financial situation that we face. However, here you go. Moving on then, Lord Mayor, to item B, which is the establishment of the local authority housing company. Lord Mayor, I move that the proposal establishment of the local authority housing company is set out on pages 157 to 166 of the council agenda be approved. The Mayor, the Deputy Mayor, the Cabinet Member for Housing and the Director of Regeneration and Employment be appointed as Directors of the Housing Company. And it's noted, as Councillor Bradford has discussed previously with myself, and I've made that commitment, that the AGM will announce the establishment of a housing select committee in a couple of months' time.
Thank you. There are no amendments. Are there any questions? Councillor Crowe.
I just wanted to speak briefly in favour of the setting up of a local authority housing company. I did have my concerns about this after the Mayor announced in the November meeting that he wanted this company to develop certain park meadows, but thankfully after the recent U-turn on the meadows, these concerns have receded. I think setting up a municipal house building company was the key pledge in my 2016 Mayoral Manifesto, so it's obviously a principle that I'm absolutely behind. I do think that under democratic control we have more of a chance of more a chance of addressing local needs and if we just leave it to the private sector, so I'm in favour.
Councillor Lutford.
I'll sleep a lot better than
On behalf of the Liberal Party group, we welcome the recommendations, but also I'm actually quite pleased that during the last debate when we were looking at it, I think it was generation, there was a prospect there was no councillors on the body. And now being moved today, there is. And I think that is important because there's a line of accountability and that is only correct, and that would say, irrespective of which party is going to establish a housing company, if the council keep it, that's important. I think we're going to say, and I don't say it in any British way, we're also going to be very careful when we take advice on people having conflict of interest where they may be deemed on planning committee or land sales, where we have the council as an owner as well as the granting authority. But I'm sure we will all take guidance on that as we had a very good planning presentation prior to the meeting tonight, by the way. Secondly, I think the other comment I'd really like to make is welcome that we establish a housing committee. I think housing is a big issue in the city, sometimes for good reasons, sometimes for bad reasons, sometimes for reasons beyond our control. But it is a big agenda, and I think sometimes the Regeneration Committee haven't been able to necessarily look at the nuances in a way that a distinct housing committee is. And I think those of us who have been on that housing committee several years ago will recall we had some very effective and very conducive presentations by all the major house association players. Councillor Burns agreed because I think she was chairing some of those meetings and they, as Council Conception was at different times. That was very conducive about teasing out the issues those housing associations were finding and making them more accountable. And I think we all benefited from that, including the housing associations. So certainly I welcome the fact the restoration of the housing committee is something my group would consider lobby, which in fairness the mayor has given credit to. And then lastly, I think the other third comment is many of our wards, particularly historical terrorist communities in Liverpool, have had real difficulties with long-term vacant properties. I think this council, and I'm pleased that when the Liberal Party moved an amendment, we rationalised full council tax at 2 months across the board. The administration accepted it with a positive response. It made the system more streamlined. And it put a disincentive to leaving derelict properties empty. A derelict property can act a conduit for crime, for the whole terrace that it's in. It can act as a fire risk for neighbours. It can act as a health risk for vermin. And you can have a danger of water penetration to the neighbouring properties. The problems with all our services suffer from a derelict property quite profound. I think one of the things that's positive about this, I hope as we go forward, we will look at, and I hope this company will be a good partner for us to look at those compulsory purchase orders for the large amounts of small plots of derelict land or derelict buildings that still plague many of the more historical communities of our city. And therefore, as I often use the phrase, we in the Liberal Party as a constructive opposition welcome this as a step forward, and we look forward to progress that we can all contribute to.
Okay, so can I move the motion to the vote?
Come back to that.
Okay, Councillor.
My answer, sir. Can I just give the assurances, Councillor Abbott, in relation to the conflict of interests or whatever? But of course, we will, in setting up the company, but also in making sure that we adhere to the normal principles that everything is above board, what we'd like to point them out. But I think most importantly, what I want to try and do with the housing company, and the directors that we've announced today are not the only directors that we will have, and there will be more councillors engaged in that. And that's why, you know, from my point of view, it's important that we establish the select committee so that people can scrutinise what's going on, what's happening, what's good, because there's nothing that we want other than transparency. And openness. And Tim, just let me address Councillor Crowe's comments about the Meadows. So what would it be now? What are you going to campaign on? What are you going to find? Because we've certainly got a lot of seats to contribute in terms of any other way, shape or form in terms of the council agenda. So it remains to be seen exactly what you're going to do, and how you're going to manage and what you're going to campaign on. But it was Keynes, I think, who once said about if the facts change. Now, we could have built on the Meadows, or I could have built on the Meadows, because we've gone through the proper processes in terms of engagement and stuff and what have you. But we had a Green Spaces review. We looked at it. The board of the Green Spaces review board was quite split in terms of on that particular piece of land. But of course, since then, we've acquired the Riverside sites, Garden Festival sites, and other pieces of land. And so we paused that particular, anything happening on that site while we waited for the local plan. The local plan's probably sort of about 37,000 spaces. So, on the Meadows, what I'm saying is, as it is, leaving it as it is, isn't an option. But you may see what happens, but as far as I'm concerned, I think the community and people that live around that particular area have the opportunity to engage with the board councillors, to engage with people, and come up with a solution that makes it a working space next to a field where they get a beautiful park. So that's fine. But with regard to the housing, Councillor Bradford, you're absolutely right for us in terms of with no housing offer other than working with RSLs and working with the private sector, and allowing them to actually do what they want. This means we take control and ownership of our destiny in terms of bringing houses. And as part of the invest-to-earn strategy, I'm absolutely convinced that with our development arm, because that's what we will have in the housing company, we can actually secure a better sustainable future for the city of Liverpool and for the people of the city.
Okay, can I put the motion to the vote? Those in favour? I'm told it's unanimous, so carried unanimous. Thank you very much indeed. Right, next item, first of the policy statement, Councillor Corbett, so one of you.
Lord Mayor, can I move that the recommendation in relation to the Fair City policy statement is set out in pages 167 to 188 of the Council and generally approved.
Any questions? Comments? unanimously. Great interest to the Lord Mayor, the Liverpool local plan finally reaches the council chamber and the council. I hope there is going to be a pleasure of moving this item.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Can I just briefly talk about the local plan, just to remind people about where we are up to, if that's okay? Just to remind people that this takes us through to 2033, and it will allow us to build nearly 85,000 new homes to meet the needs of our growing population, all on brownfield land, providing places for work for nearly 38,000, covering around about 450 hectares, which is the equivalent to 254 acres in size. It protects and manages development in our open space and natural and historic environment, and makes sure that that's significantly protected. Promoting better new quality homes that are wheelchair accessible, meeting residents' needs throughout their lifetime if necessary. Councillor Pam Thomas has been absolutely fundamental in making sure that we get that spot on. Increasing the supply of affordable homes, managing the over-concentration of developments such as hot food takeaways and houses of multiple occupation, promoting key development areas in the city centre, something we've never had before. So we've got Baltic Triangle in the south, 10 streets in the north, Paddington Village in the west, and our waterfronts. So all of that is protected. We've got new skyline policies in this. So we've used the local plan not only because it's required by governments, it means now that we believe that this is the best document to be taken forward. We will be submitting it to government following tonight's council meeting and allow people there to pass forward any views that they have through to government office. But I believe this document is a solid document and allows us to grow the city the way we want it to for the next 15 years. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Kemp.
Thank you, my Lord Mayor. You might think that I'd take a New Year's resolution because I would be nice to the administration again today. It wasn't a New Year's resolution because none of my New Year's resolutions have ever made the 24th of January. I'm doing it because I think this is an important document that this council should unanimously support. That doesn't mean to say that we agree with absolutely everything in it. This is a 1900-page document. But there are ways in which we can raise our concerns through a proper consultation process, which the council will have to respond to, into the inspectorate process, which will sign this off or send it back to us. So I will say that we do have concerns still about the World Heritage Site. We do have concerns about the quality of building. By that I don't mean the wheelchair access and things like that we talked about before, but the fact that we're building homes in this city and in others with very flimsy materials without proper breaks between houses, in our view. And we still have concerns about the possibility of building on commercial and industrial land and moving that into residential. We're not quite sure that those are here yet, but we will make our comments about those. But the reason we will support it is because we believe that this statement deals with the main problems which this city council is facing. And I must tell you, as a member of the planning committee, I actually feel empowered if this document goes through today, as I'm sure it will. I regularly raise the questions of student accommodation. Not only the number, but also whether or not, if the market changes, the student accommodation can be changed to anything else. If this goes through, the government, never mind if it goes through here, we will be able to deal with that. I am concerned about the over-provision of apartments in our city centre, some of which we will not now be able to do because we can't retrospectively go back to do things that we might otherwise have done differently. But for example, we know that there are 26,000 planning permissions for which no building work has yet started. I got a list of those sites, and it looks, I've had up every single one, but it looks between 21 and 22,000 of those are one and two bedroom flats in the city centre. I do not believe there is that much demand for one and two bedroom flats in the city centre, because we already have 9,000 empty properties, of which 4,000 are in the city centre, one and two bedroom flats. I just cannot see the market for that number. And that's why I welcome within the framework the diversity of properties which are called for here, which will actually be every market that we need. So we want to have young and old, rich and poor, people of all the diversities that Liverpool has, working and living together inside our city. So we could have tried to move an amendment today with our nickels. We've decided not to do that. There's a process for dealing with this. I think that this is fundamentally a good document. I look forward to using it next Tuesday at our planning committee, as I'm told I can do, and I hope we can work together to deal with some of those issues which I've highlighted tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor.
Just begin by thanking all the officers who have put together such a detailed and considered document. I know it's been an absolutely huge piece of work. And I have to say that there is a lot within it that I do agree with, and I'm really happy to support, and I look forward to wielding in future planning committees. For example, new powers on HMOs, fast food establishments, and accessibility requirements in new homes. These are good things. And there are some bad things in it, but I'm realistic enough to know that I wouldn't agree with every single policy within the document. And I would have voted for publishing the plan if I only had minor misgivings. However, I can't vote in favour of it because of a range of reductions and protections for green space within it. For example, the latest wording of the green waste policy is a major watering down of the protection which it previously enjoyed. The wording in the UDP, which is the current planning document, says planning permission will not be granted for, and I quote, new development that would affect the predominantly open character of the green wedges, or reduce the physical separation between the existing built-up areas. The wording in the new policy GI2 within the local plan reads, the development, and I quote, should demonstrate that it will not have a significant adverse effect on the predominantly open character of the green wedge by significantly reducing the physical separation between built-up areas. The word significant is significant. It introduces ambiguity which people can open up to interpretation. And I'm of the opinion that this is a deliberate change made so that the administration can reserve the right to build on green wedge if it serves their overriding priority of promoting economic growth. As a Green, I do not believe that protecting the environment can play second fiddle to economic growth. Liverpool should take a look instead of what Birmingham Council's document, Green Living Spaces. In the foreword, it says, a healthy natural environment is not a luxury, something we can think about after we fix the economy or problems with physical and mental health and education. The natural environment provides the fundamental underpinnings for a healthy, successful society. If we vote to publish this, we're effectively saying the document is perfect, it doesn't need changes, and we can't go back and revise it. In my opinion, we need to pause the publishing of the local plan until the protections for green space have been revised. So I urge the council to vote no, to vote against.
Thank you,
Councillor. Thank you,
Lord Mayor. I'd like to particularly thank the Deputy Mayor and her councillor and officer colleagues for their work on this document. I'd particularly like to thank Councillor O'Byrne and the other people who worked on it for finding the sufficient brownfield sites to meet the very exacting housing targets that we are giving the city and that we do need to regenerate our city and to grow our city. It isn't a perfect document, that's right. There's lots and lots of good things in there. I especially welcome the efforts to deal with the over-concentration of the takeaways and the HMOs, which many of us turn up to for the planning committee week after week. And until now, we haven't been able to take action on, but this allows us now to take action and to develop our city in the way that we, as a Labour Council, would want to develop it. I'll remind people that those conversions to HMOs and extending those HMOs doesn't contribute to the targets at all, so it's not helping the city in that sense. It's just overcrowding the areas that are adversely affected by those. Council members may be aware that, because
we got the letter back from Sajid Javid that by meeting those housing targets, that has enabled us to meet the government's bar to put our housing application planning fees on. Council members may not be aware, but I took the trouble to find out that means an extra £600,000 a year coming into our city for our planning department by being able to put those fees up, which absolutely proves that at the last full council we were all correct in supporting that move and supporting the LGA's campaign on that, and how much that needed to be done. This was meant to be a question, not a statement. I'll just remind other speakers. So my question, just to double check, in the report it says here, the Assistant Director of Development and Investment, I'm not completely sure who that is, in liaison with the Deputy Mayor, they do have the delegated authority to do minor changes to the plan. So just double checking how minor those minor changes are, that they are kind of correcting typos and stuff, and not, for example, changing any designation or anything. Thank you.
Councillor.
Thanks, Lord Mayor. If I can start and work forward. So, we talk about markets, who's the officer who will be working with us. So it might be, for example, some of the language that's used. For example, I know that Councillor Thomas has been working really close with me. We've been checking through absolutely everything. And there are some ways that we've just clarified to make sure there's no ambiguity. And there's a few more things that we need to go through to do that. So that's the type of way that we're talking about. It's not fundamental changes to the document. If I can answer your questions, it was about how we use this document now. And you're absolutely right. At the pre-scrutiny that we had at Regen Select, we were talking about once we submit this document, although we still have to wait to the existing UDP, or I now is on the local plan, and we will be talking to developers to say to them, this is what's going through. It may take 12 months, but we're expecting you to be looking at this. The local plan gives us greater powers, more powers than we've ever had. And of course, this government's focus is on development first. It's always in favour of the developer. We've used the opportunity of the local plan to try and give control back to the council and back to the planning authority, which is exactly what you want us to see happen, so that we can start to make a difference in our communities and grow the city in exactly the way that we need it to going forward, to make sure that there's those job opportunities for our people. Oh, Councillor Crone, we've just been saying, haven't we, what on earth has he got to campaign on now? And it's just like, he just hasn't read it, has he? We've got a policy here that strengthens our green space more than we've ever had. It means that for the first time, a developer cannot come forward and say, I want to build big. We can say, no, and this is the reason why. If we don't have the local plan in place, it means the developers can start to come forward and we have no power to restrict that. Councillor Crone, at the Regeneration Committee before last, had a go about the plan not coming forward. I gave very clear guidelines as to when it would be coming and it would come to this council meeting. And I received an email from him saying, that's far too late. Now he's saying, let's delay this. You know, he just can't make up his mind, can he? The reason why we've got the plan the way we have is to make sure we put in the strongest possible protections we can. So that goes from Greenbelt to green wedge and green open space in that area. That's exactly how it should be. The group that we are saying very loud and clear that we have given restrictions so when a developer comes forward, our planning committee can reject those in the strongest possible terms. I don't know how much clearer I can be. I know you're desperate for something to campaign on, but you know, you've just failed once again. I'm sorry, Councillor Crone.
Brian.
Hello, Mayor. I haven't got a question, but I do want to make a point of an actual example of what Anne was talking about. I went to our planning inquiry, which I know some of the opposition were present at, about the Elton Priory planning application. Now, if we had that local plan in place, I strongly feel that our planning officers, who did a wonderful job, would have had that local plan to back them up about significant change coming about. As it is, we really don't know how the planning inspector is going to come out on this. But we were in a weak position, in my opinion, because the local plan wasn't there in place. So thanks for that, and I just wanted to back you up with a great example.
Okay, so we move to the vote. Those in favour?
Support and help people. And you know, we have been inundated with
thank yous and people congratulating us for the support that we gave them. And I think, again, I'd just like to put on record my thanks to those staff who were on car park duty, but also those that were on duty at the Arena and Convention Centre, the Pullman Hotel, Jolie's, the Hilton, all of those that went the extra mile to support the city during difficult times. What I also done is I wrote to the Association of British Insurers to ask them to urge their members to quickly resolve and deal with people's insurance claims. I got a letter, I got a letter yesterday to say that they're telling me that 96% of the claims have already been met, and they're delighted with that. I think on Saturday we had a meeting with a number of people that were affected by the fire. We were coming to the city into one of our hotels where our officers have been there to give them support. We've also put support, including legal advice, available to people. We actually rescued the discs that were in the CCTV within the car park, and that's been enhanced and made viewable. And we've given them to individual insurance companies. We also sent a drone inside the car park, and then individuals where we could safely put people to film cars that were there, and to also give information to those people that were making claims. So we've done all we can to support and help people in the best way that we possibly can. Some of the questions asked, of course, some people want to make politics, of course, which is often the case with elected members here. You were talking about sprinklers and stuff, and whether we were fulfilling our duties. Of course we were, in the same way that the thousands of other car parks around the country. It meets all the statutory requirements and plans, and as I say, car parks are for parking your car, not for going in and staying in them. So indeed we did. What I can tell you is that the fire started on the third floor. It was started in a 16-year-old car that looks like it had been converted to a different type of fuel arrangement. Now, we suspect that that has been insured by the insurance company that insured the car, and I'm sure that will be taken into account by those that are making the investigations. But from our point of view, we've had complete cooperation from our insurance, and we are dealing with them the appropriate way, obviously, and we would expect that our full costs are met within the insurance. And what I can say is that our officers, as I said, immediately were on site with me in the evening time of the incident of the following morning on New Year's Day. I'm working there all day. I'm making contact with people who actually lay tarmac and do all of those things. And as you can see, within a matter of a week, around about 4 weeks of work was actually done in an urgent way. And I pay tribute to our delegation team and all the staff, Andy Barmore, Kit, Nick Cabane, and all of his team, the arena staff, the car park staff, and indeed our partners who we work with, but actually doing the work that they've done, because every lost time, every hour lost or whatever is money to the City Council. So we're actually looking at building even more space in that particular area as we look at reconfiguring the site. So things are in hand, and that's why I always make it very, very clear how privileged we are to have such dedicated and professional and responsible staff. So I thank them all for what they've done so quickly on our behalf. Okay, just a number of other things, Lord Mayor. Reports in local press around the Everton Football Club and our partnership with Everton Football Club. A lot of people have been asking questions, rightly so, around our arrangements with Everton Football Club, as people in the council will know, and certainly we've discussed and talked about our original arrangements with the football club, was to look at securitising an amount of money that they would borrow and we would securitise. And we asked questions around, as we were getting asked to securitise the loan week against the private sector company loan and money to Ellison, to do more in terms of securitisation. So we asked the question whether it would be more beneficial for us to do the loan rather than securitisation, or we agree the loan and do the securitisation. That's been looked at by financial individuals, agencies, and basically they've come back and said, yes, you can do it, yes, it would be more beneficial to you, and yes, you can securitise it. That's actually what's been looked at the minute it's gone back. The due diligence has been sent out to different people to have a look at. We've either looked at it over legally, or either looked at over financially, and we're making sure that it is de-risked. When we get to that stage, it will come back for scrutiny at select committee, regeneration, audit select committee, cameras, seminar, back to the full council for everybody to look at in an open and transparent way. And we will only do the deal if it benefits the city of Liverpool. But I want to pick up on some of the points, and again, in particular, he's not here, Councillor Maitland, but I wanted to address some of the issues that he's raised in the local press about borrowing, and he talks about, and it's relevant here because I'm going to talk to you in a bit, in a second, about the budget and about the motion that we're going to discuss around children's care and adult social care and the pressures that we're under. And we talk about borrowing, he talks about borrowing. I actually just got some figures around the Liberal Democrat borrowing. And if you remember the AGM last year, I talked to you about the £130 million debt that we inherited when we took control. And I mentioned to you about the fact that they hadn't dealt with the single status, equal pay. It's great to see our union colleagues there who we immediately got on with and sort of resolved that issue. But they hadn't dealt with that £67 million debt, the adult social care debt and children's £18 million at the time, adding up to a whopping total of about £130 million, which was the equivalent of a full year's council tax. Not only did they do that, but of course, then, you know, it's great because I love it when they lead with the chin and expose themselves, asking questions around our borrowing. Our borrowing is the cheapest of any core city in the country. Even Spellingthorpe borrowed £240 million for the development and make money. Warrington, half the size of us, the Amiga site, £300 million borrowing, all to bring in revenue to help pay for services. And that's fine, it's called Invest to Win, and I have absolutely no problem with it because it's a model that I've adopted here in the city over the last few years. Indeed, over the last 4 years, we now generate more money than we did 4 years ago to the tune of £12 million, which we get from investments that we've made that we now get as a result of Invest to Win. Now, the millstones that we were left around our neck by the Liberal Democrats, which we still have to pay, ironically, is roughly the same amount of money, or near enough, as we receive. So our investments bring in £12 million, and the debt that we still have to pay, with the Liberal Democrats, and their total of £647 million borrowing, is Parthenon School, £104 million, Central Library, £165 million, Schools PFI, which schools still pay back today, with us, £365 million, Waivertree Pool, £13 million, and of course it was £21 million, that's what's being paid off. So in total, £647 million, with repayments of £11.4 million we have to find every single year before we even start working on the budget. So you can see where our investments are bringing a return, and their investments as a millstone still round our neck and schools' neck, and they have a cheap to insult us when we're trying to actually pay for services that we desperately need with the city. So let's bring the debate on. Let's have that debate about what's the best way actually creating debt with no investment,
or borrowing to actually bring in a revenue, because we're capital rich and revenue poor, and this administration is trying to tackle that. So let's let us look forward to that. But it links back to the budget. And you'll notice that we've got a motion on the agenda today, which talks about the serious issues, the problems that we face in relation to children's social care. Okay, now as much as Barry tries to, Councillor Kushner tries to deal with the issues and the support of giving to that particular area, the pressures are continually mounting for us. So we have an added pressure on our spend, and don't forget we're cutting 30 million this year up to March. 30 million 18-19, and then another 30 million 19-20. That's what we've got to find. And if rate support grant, as it's going to be in 2020, is taken off us, if it was today, we would be £55 million worse off. We now spend somewhere in the region of £250 million in social care. That's what we now spend. £250 million in social care, and we receive £174 million in council tax and around £200 million in business rates. But the reality is that ain't going to keep us going. That ain't going to pay for the services that we need. And we have a real difficult dilemma to face. Even if we were just to say we'll pay for our statutory responsibilities and statutory duties in adults and children's care, we still will have enough to pay for those services. Unless we start making invest-to-earn, and unless we start increasing taxes, we can't pay for it. We've got a fair funding review that the government's undertaking. We don't know when that's going to produce a report that says this is what they could possibly do. But one thing I can guarantee you the Tories won't do is that increase the money to local government. They just simply will not do it, so we're on our own. And that's why, in terms of sustaining our city and putting resilience into our services, the only way is actually building more revenue coming into the city for a sustainable future for the people of this city. And that's what we're trying to do. So yes, I'm absolutely aware of the pain and the damage that an increase in council tax will do, because we understand and we know that the majority of those people live in the poorest areas and in council properties that are terraced houses. But the dilemma and the conundrum is, how do we pay for the statutory services? How do we support those people that need those services without the money coming in? There is no quick fix or easy solution to that, otherwise we'd have found it years ago. And the reality is, I stood in this chamber round about 6 years ago now. This will be the eighth year that I've led this council, but 6-7 years ago, I remember being in this chamber, and Roger Phillips chaired the debate, where people told me this city would be on its knees within 6 months. This city would collapse in 6 months, it isn't. It hasn't collapsed, it's still here, it's still fighting. And we'll still provide the services as best we can with the money that we've got. We'll still be open for solutions, because that is the pragmatic response of absolutely committed people to the people of this city. That's what we will find, and that's what we will do, and that's what we will give. But the reality is that we